Not only does the crucifixion and resurrection of Christ stand at the very center of Christianity, it actually stands at the center of world history. Every time you write the date, you are writing about Jesus Christ. Let me read some verses to you from 1 Corinthians chapter 1. And while you're turning there, This, of course, is Easter weekend. Many of you were here on Friday when we had several services at which we looked at the actual crucifixion of Christ. And this morning, of course, the resurrection of Christ. And these are events that lie at the very heart and center of the Christian message. Now, they don't make sense outside of a framework, a theological framework, an understanding of what exactly was going on. And there is a lot of confusion as to what was going on, perhaps. A lot of indifference as to what was going on. I was talking to a lady yesterday who teaches in one of the schools here in Toronto. She said earlier in the week, they announced that they would have this weekend off, the Easter weekend. And the person making the announcement said, this is when Christians celebrate the crucifixion of Christ and his resuscitation. Well, I don't know if the crucifixion is in the dictionary, but this is not a resuscitation. That argument has been addressed many times. We're talking about dealing with a Christ who conquered death, and how and why, and I'm going to read you from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18, down to verse 25. And this is what Paul says when he writes this. He says, the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I'll destroy the wisdom of the wise, the intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate. Where is the wise man? Where is the scholar? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. Jews demand miraculous signs, and Greeks look for wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than man's wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than man's strength. That's as far as I'm going to read, and if you're following it in your Bible, keep it open. We'll come back to those verses in just a moment. A Washington Post journalist by the name of Gene Weingarten won the Pulitzer Prize a while ago for an article he wrote, which he entitled Pearls Before Breakfast. It was about a busker playing a violin at the top of the escalator outside the L'Enfant Station Plaza in Washington, D.C. Hidden from view was a video camera set up to record the event, and the busker played some of the most inspiring classical music ever written, and the commuters just walked on by and by and large ignored him. The violinist was Joshua Bell, one of the most famous violinists in the world. And the violin he was playing was a Stradivarius, which had been built in 1713 by Antonio Stradivari, one of the family of Stradivari, who built these incredible violins that are still being played today. This one was a combination of the finest spruce, maple, and willow, and built to such perfection that if you shaved off a millimeter of wood anywhere on that violin, it would unbalance the sound. The violin had been purchased for a reported $3.5 million. Now, Joshua Bell normally plays in the great concert halls of Moscow, St. Petersburg, Vienna, Prague, London, Paris, New York. People pay a lot of money to go to hear him play. He earns up to $1,000 a minute for his actual playing. And on this particular morning, he walked into the exit of the L'Enfant Plaza station, positioned himself against a wall next to a trash basket. He was wearing jeans, a long-sleeved t-shirt, a baseball cap, and he removed his violin from its case and placed the case open on the ground in front of him, threw in some change to encourage donation, and he began to play. Every time a train pulled into the station, people streamed up out of the subway. Joshua Bell played for 47 minutes, over 1,000 people passed him. Hardly anyone stopped to listen. There were one or two children being brought by a parent or an adult, and all the children, without exception, were intrigued, interested. They wanted to stop and see, and the parent or guardian pulled them, dragged them, and took them on to wherever they were heading. 27 people put money into his violin case. It came to $31.21. Only one person recognized him. The Washington Post placed a few reporters around the exit, and they stopped some of the folks coming out, and they said, "We're doing an article on commuting. Could we have your telephone number? We'd like to call you later in the day and ask a few questions." And of those who gave the telephone numbers, they called them and asked them if they had seen anything unusual at the station that morning. Most could not remember anything out of the ordinary. Some mentioned the busker. A lady who worked at nearby shoe shine said that if anybody started busking, she normally called the station security or the police to move them because she could never hear her customers when they were playing music next to her. But on this morning, she was already cleaning somebody's shoes when he started playing. And when she'd finished cleaning, she thought, you know, he's not bad. And so she decided not to call the authorities, though she said he was a bit loud. When the journalists told the people they were talking to that this was Joshua Bell, one of the most famous violinists in the world, playing a Stradivarius that cost $3.5 million, they were astounded. And the Washington Post mused about this in a very interesting article. Some things they talked about was, if a great musician plays great music but no one hears, is he any good? It's a bit like the old chestnut about if a tree falls down in the forest and nobody's there, does it make a noise? They asked the question, is beauty measurable or is it merely an opinion? Or is it colored by the state of mind of the observer at the time? Is beauty a luxury? Is it largely irrelevant to the nitty-gritty of life? No one expected a famous and proficient violinist to be playing a $3.5 million violin at that time of the morning at the exit of a station. They didn't expect him, so they didn't recognize him, so they didn't hear him. This is Easter weekend. It's the occasion when, in particular, we focus on the historicity of the death of Jesus Christ, his burial, and his resurrection from the dead. Not only does the crucifixion and resurrection of Christ stand at the very center of Christianity, it actually stands at the center of world history. Every time you write the date, you are writing about Jesus Christ. History is divided into BC and AD. Yet, if Jesus Christ is co-equally God with the Father and co-equally God with the Holy Spirit, what in the world is he doing on a cross? That is the last place you'd expect to see him. You see, if we explore the issue of God, we tend to, when we discuss this and talk about it and think about it, think in terms of the big things. We think in terms of the big questions. We talk about the origin of the universe, and that's an endless debate. We talk about the complexities of life. We talk about the vastness of time and space. We talk about the fact that we live on a tiny little speck of dust floating around a star in the outer regions of the Milky Way, which until 80 years ago we thought was the universe. And then we discovered in 1923, at least Hubble discovered, that there was a galaxy outside of ours, Andromeda. You can see it with the naked eye if you know what you're looking for. It's 2.2 million light years away. Then discovered a third, then a fourth, then a fifth, and the current count is 140 billion galaxies, all of which consist of billions of stars. The furthest from us is 13.5 billion light years away. We can't comprehend those kind of figures, of course. But when we talk about God, we talk in these kind of stratospheric terms. And the arguments are non-conclusive when you talk in those terms. If we bring this question down to our own experience and life, we tend to talk about suffering. We ask the question, where was God in the earthquakes that have hit so much of the world? Japan, before that, Haiti, New Zealand. We ask, where is God in the HIV/AIDS pandemic that has left 14.5 million orphans in Africa alone? Right now, these are the issues we talk about. But a crucifixion and a burial and a resurrection in an obscure Roman province called Judea in a primitive society 2,000 years ago. What's that all about? What does that seemingly come to the forefront and become the headline? Richard Dawkins is the author of The God Delusion. He was formerly professor for public understanding of science at Oxford University. He's now retired from that. A little while ago, he debated John Lennox, who is professor of mathematics at Oxford University. And I once invited John Lennox here, and some of you may have been here 7 years or so ago. He came and spoke one Sunday. And Dawkins and John Lennox, both professors within the science departments of the University of Oxford, debated at the Oxford Museum of Natural History. They debated existence of God. At one point, and I've seen a DVD of this, at one point, Dawkins says of John Lennox, and I quote you word for word, he believes that the creator of the universe, the God who devised the laws of physics, the laws of mathematics, the physical constants, who devised the parsecs of space, billions of light years of space, billions of years of time, that this genius of mathematics and physical science could not think of a better way to rid the world of sin than to come to this little speck of cosmic dust and have himself tortured and executed so that he could forgive. That, says Dawkins, that is profoundly unscientific. Not only is it unscientific, but it doesn't do justice to the grandeur of the universe. It is petty, it is small, it is pathetic. And that's the God, said Dawkins, that Christians believe in. It's petty, it's small-minded, but that is the very point. It appears so to be Christ on the cross is in the wrong place for God. It's like being blindsided in the subway station on a Friday morning in Washington, D.C. at 7:50 a.m. in a hurry to get to work, and you pass by one of the most brilliant violinists in the world playing some of the most beautiful music in the world and one of the most expensive violins in the world. You don't expect it, and you don't see it. Here's where you expect to see Joshua Bell. You will pay a lot of dollars for that. $100 won't get you a very good seat. That's where you expect to see Joshua Bell. That's why his two concerts in Toronto next month will sell out. At Easter, we're looking in the place the people don't expect to see God in action. To the vast majority of people, it makes no sense. Because although we might believe in God, we don't expect to see him there. And that's why Paul wrote in the verses I read to you earlier, in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 22, he said, Jews demand miraculous signs. Yeah, we can go with that. The big, flashy demonstration. We can go with that. He then says, Greeks look for wisdom. As I'll show in a moment, the Greeks were famous for their philosophical thinking. They'd expect that to lead them to God. But he says, we preach Christ crucified. It's a stumbling block to Jews, of course it is, and it's foolishness to Gentiles, of course it is. Let me talk about this, because Paul isn't randomly saying Jews and Greeks. Those were the folks who made up the people who would have read this letter, because Corinth, of course, was in Greece. When Paul first came to Corinth, he began to meet with the Jewish community there. There was a sizable Jewish community, part of the Jewish diaspora that over the previous couple of hundred years had spread out throughout the Mediterranean world, and there was a large community of them in Corinth. When Paul came there, that's who he met with first. He began to speak in their synagogue until eventually they kicked him out. And then he began to speak to the people at large and the crowds at large that would gather in the city of Corinth. And he's saying to them, in effect, I know your city. I know the folks are going to be reading this. You're made up of Jews, you're made up of Greeks, and you Jews are looking in miraculous signs for the evidence of God, and you Greeks are finding him through wisdom or trying to find him through wisdom. I want to tell you, the message we have is not about that at all. And you'll find him, of all places, on a cross. Now, why was this a stumbling block to Jews? He says Jews demand miraculous signs, and this becomes a stumbling block to Jews because the God they were interested in was a God of power. They wanted to know a God who is omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent, immutable. Those are all big words, just to let you know I know them. What they mean is all-powerful, all-knowing, in all places, unchanging. And of course, so he is. in the Jewish scriptures, which is now our Old Testament, 333 times God is spoken of as being God Almighty or the Lord Almighty. No question about that. But they were comfortable with his mighty works in history, in the creation of the world, in the deliverance of them as a people from their years of bondage in Egypt. They loved the great work of God in Moses and Joshua, the exploits of David and Solomon, their greatest kings. They loved the great events that characterized prophets like Elijah and Isaiah and Ezekiel and Daniel. This is the stuff of the Jewish God. These were their great heroes. On a Roman cross, described by the scriptures as despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering? No. So much so that when Jesus Christ was on the cross outside the city of Jerusalem, it says in Matthew 27, verse 39, those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "Save yourself, come down from the cross if you are the Son of God. If you are who you're claiming to be, don't kid around, demonstrate it, come down from the cross." But they didn't stop long enough to see if he might. They fully knew that he wouldn't, and they kept going because who is this man? And so John tells us in a very sad verse in John's Gospel, chapter 1, he came to his own, but his own did not receive him, didn't recognize him. They were looking in the wrong place. Why is it foolishness to Greeks? I mean, what is the concert hall where the Greeks would expect to find God? Well, of course, Greeks, as Paul said, look for wisdom. They're renowned for it. They produce the great philosophers, the great thinkers of the age, whose philosophies still influence Western thought. The big three were Socrates and Plato and Aristotle, who lived in the 4th and 5th centuries before Christ. They all talked about God. Socrates said he was compelled to follow God because he believed there was a human soul. We're more than just a physical body. There was a soul, and that soul was eternal. That was Socrates' conclusion. But he didn't quite know who the God was who's behind this, so he became polytheistic eventually. His student was Plato, 40 years younger. Plato spoke of the gods, plural, but said it's impossible to talk about God in human words. So he said we can only talk about God negatively by defining who he is not and stating what we do not believe, because that is the only way you can begin to understand him, which is a very interesting approach, because God is bigger than human mind, of course. His student was Aristotle, and Aristotle devised the theory of the unmoved mover, which is still around, and people still talk about this. What he said was this: there exists movement in the world, and things that move are set in motion by something else. But if everything that moves was caused to move by something else, there would be an infinite chain of causes, and that, said Aristotle, could not happen. And so there must be at the beginning an unmoved mover that causes the first movement, that causes the effect and the effect and the effect. There must be the first flicking of the domino that knocks the whole lot of dominoes down. And the unmoved mover, said Aristotle, is God. Well, a bit of logical thinking, and reasonably logical thinking. A rotten tomato suddenly came flying onto this platform and hit me. You might look at me and probably laugh, but you'd look in the direction from which it came. Who threw that? Somebody on the balcony threw that. You know, rotten tomatoes don't just fly around on their own. There's a cause behind it. We know that. So that was Aristotle's idea. But what kind of God is that? That gives us no indication whatsoever. Just a big, powerful force. Bang! But the Greeks loved this kind of speculation and philosophy. And it's good. We're rational beings. We must think rationally. We don't bury our brains. But Paul says, the only problem is this. If the Jews are looking for the flash, bang, miracle, dynamism, power, and the Greeks are looking for the impressive wisdom and insights and ideas that point us back to God, the real message, he said, that we have to offer people is not about that at all. It's Christ crucified. So what in the world was happening? What is it about? In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19, Paul wrote this, God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. Something was going on, Paul said, in Christ that was having the effect of reconciling the world to himself. Let me explain this just as simply as I can. What makes the cross of Christ necessary are two things in the character of God. God is just and God is merciful. The only problem is justice and mercy are incompatible with one another. Justice, you see, is giving people what they deserve. Tit for tat, as justice. Mercy is not giving people what they deserve. So you can't give somebody what they deserve and not give them what they deserve at the same time. Justice and mercy, though separately existing and fine, in the integrity of God's character, justice and mercy cannot be applied to the same context at the same time, for they're incompatible. Unless there is the introduction of a third party. Let me give you a simple, inadequate illustration, but it'll make the particular point I want to make. Supposing I was driving my car down Shepherd Avenue outside of this building at 80 kilometers an hour, and the limit is, what's the limit? 60, okay, you know. I should know. And a car with a flashing lights pulls up behind me, pulls me over. You're driving at 80 kilometers an hour? Yes, I am. You know the limit of this? Yes, somebody just told me it's 60. You're 20 kilometers over? Yes, I understand. You know, that's against the law? Yeah. Okay. I'm summoned to appear in court. I know it doesn't happen this way. I know it happens on the spot. So I go to the court, suppose I do, stand the magistrate says to me, are you guilty or not guilty of driving your car at 80 kilometers an hour and a 60 kilometer limit? I say, guilty, Your Honor. He has now one of two options. He can deal with me justly and he can fine me, or he can deal with me mercifully and say, well, I understand you got a clean record, so it's okay, don't do it again, off you go. But he can't do both. The only way justice and mercy is reconciled is if the magistrate acts justly and says, because you are guilty, I'm going to fine you $120. And I say, oh boy, $120, man alive. And then I have a very good friend, I don't really have friends like this, who says, what do I do? I say, they fine me. How much do they fine you? $120. Wow. Have you got that? No, I don't. Well, I'll tell you what, I got my checkbook with me. I write out to the Toronto City Council, nasty, awkward bureaucrats. Is that what we call it? I don't know what we call it. Write a check, $120. Goes to the clerk of the court. Here's a check for Charles Price's fine. The record of that courtroom says this: Charles Price, crime, speeding on Shepherd Avenue, guilty, fine $120, paid. The justice of the court has been met. But because of the introduction of a third party, I have become the recipient of mercy. Somebody else has absorbed my fine for me. It's an adequate illustration because much more was going on the cross, but it expresses that point. God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself. God, in the integrity of his character, demands justice be done. The soul that sins shall die. The wage of sin is, that's a present tense thing, by the way, is. We are born in that state of being separated from God. We inherit that fallen condition. That's why our lives are messed up. But Christ stepped into your place and my place as our substitute, the only one with the right to do so if we had no sin of his own. And he satisfied the justice of God to such an extent that in consequence, you and I can be forgiven for the purpose of that reconciliation with God being made real. You see, the Christian message is all about reconciliation with God. And for that to take place, that barrier must be broken down. It was broken down in the cross when he took on himself all the sins of the world. He who knew no sin, the Bible tells us, was made to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ. And that's why today we're able to be forgiven. We sang a few songs about this earlier. Do you know, forgiveness is one of the greatest needs that people have, one of the greatest psychological needs. I think I mentioned this to you before, but some years ago, I was listening to a BBC radio. I was driving my car, and the head of a psychiatric hospital in Scotland was being interviewed. In the course of the interview, he said this, and it struck me so much, I pulled off the road and wrote it down. He said, if my patients could be assured of forgiveness, half of them could go home tomorrow. That one of the root causes of the breakdown, he said, in people's lives was unresolved guilt. Now, I know there's a false guilt. I know there's a guilt that has no real warrant, and a lot of us are very vulnerable to that, but there is real guilt as well. Of course there is. Newsweek magazine reported an American psychiatrist saying, and I quote, 95% of insanity in the USA has its roots in the refusal of people to accept forgiveness. I have no way of verifying that figure. But the breakdown in people's lives often can be traced back to guilt that has been unresolved. And when you and I come to the cross of Christ and recognize here is the means, the way back by which I can be reconciled to God, because as my substitute, Christ gave himself in my place, then we can have that wonderful freedom of being forgiven. The baggage cleaned up. What does God do with our sin? Here's some verses in the Bible. As far as the east is from the west, so far as he removed our transgressions from us. That's in Psalm 103. It's very interesting. He doesn't say as far as the north is from the south, because the north is a fixed point. There's a north pole and a south pole. If you go north, you fly over the north pole and begin to go south. But if you go east, you'll keep going east, never begin to go west. If you go west, you'll keep going west, never begin to go east. It's as far as the east is from the west, infinity, immeasurably. That's the picture he uses to say this is what God does with your sin. He removes it so far. Not only that, but Isaiah 38 says, you put all my sins behind your back. Where is there such a place that's behind God's back? Well, it's so removed that it doesn't exist. That's where he puts your sin, he says. Isaiah 43 says, I am he who blots out your transgressions and remembers your sins no more. God has this wonderful ability to remember our sins no more. Doesn't mean he's forgetful, but he never recalls it, never brings it back. It's over, past, done, gone. I wish we believed that, because some of us don't. I heard about two brothers one day who were fighting all day. At the end of the day, the mother went to the older of the two brothers and said, look, before you go to bed, make it up with your brother. You've been fighting all day. He said, I'm not going to make it up with him. It's his fault. He hit me first. She said, but you're the older one. He hit me first. I'm not going to make it up with him. He doesn't deserve it. So the mother tried to appeal to his sentiment a little bit. And she said, just suppose if during the night your brother died, wouldn't you be sorry in the morning if you hadn't forgiven him? So the boy thought a moment and said, all right, I'll forgive him. But if he's alive in the morning, there may be some of us here today and you're scared about the morning. Listen, it's done. You know what Romans 8:1 says? There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ. No condemnation. But that's not the end purpose. The end purpose is not just to forgive and clean us up. Because there's a verse that is an important verse about what took place on the cross. In Romans 5, verse 10, it says, if when we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved by his life? He says, we're reconciled to God by the death of Jesus Christ. That's what reconciles us to God. But now, here's something much more. We're being saved day by day by his life. In fact, the Amplified Version of the Bible says, now that we are reconciled, we shall be saved, daily delivered from sin's dominion through his resurrection life. You see, Christ wasn't just raised from the dead in order to impress a few folks. Wow, look at that. No, but having been raised from the dead and then ascended to his Father, he might pour out and give his Holy Spirit to live the life of Jesus Christ in us. That living in us, he might be the one who saves us daily, sets us free, as that verse says. See, our problem is not just what we do, it's what we are. Here's what Paul says about himself when he's very honest in Romans chapter 7. He says, I do not understand what I do. For what I want to do, I don't do. What I hate doing, I do. And what I do is not the good I want to do. No, the evil I do not want to do. This is what I keep on doing. Very simply, the things in life that are good and they're right and I like them, I want to do them, but I don't. The things in life that are wrong, I don't like them, I don't want to do them. And I said to myself, I'll never ever do them again. But you never guess what happens. I do them. Anybody here got that problem? Come on, a bit of honesty here. Then he goes on to say this, if I do what I don't want to do, it's no longer I who do it, it's sin living in me that does it. So he says, there's something in me that is out of my control, that is pulling me down all the time, but there's an antidote to it. And that antidote, he says in Galatians 2:20, that I've been crucified with Christ, I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. Look at those two verses together. It's no longer I who do it, but sin living in me. That's what pulls me down. That's the inner brokenness of my own life and my own soul. I am broken. I'm dysfunctional. And I can intend all kinds of things, but I don't accomplish them. I find myself pulled down. Because it's not I who do it, but sin living in me. The antidote is, it's no longer I who live, but Christ living in me. That the guiding power of our lives is either the old natural nature, which is broken and called sin, or the life of Jesus Christ that's been given to us on the basis of our confession of our sin and our need of Christ, and we receive him into our lives that he might now live in us a new quality of life. And as Paul says, what you discover then is that Christ is the power of God. Christ is the wisdom of God. The things that Jews are looking for, they will find them. The things the Greeks are looking for, they actually find them by his presence working and operating within us. Let me give an illustration as I come to the end. I steal this from a man called D.R. Moody, but he's been dead for 100 years, so he doesn't mind. He was a very famous preacher back in the 19th century. And D.R. Moody, apparently, would very often hold up a glove, and I have one here this morning. And he would say, this glove was made in the image and likeness of a hand. You recognize it. It's got a thumb, it's got fingers, it's got a palm, it's got a wrist. Very much, said Moody, as human beings were made in the image of God. Not a physical image, but a moral image. Our character is intended to display his character. And so Moody would say, this glove, you recognize it, it's made in the image of likeness of a hand. So he put the glove down on the desk like that and say, glove, you are made in the image of a hand. You got fingers, a thumb, a palm, and a wrist. Here's a book. Would you please pick up the book for me? And Moody would say, glove, I'm talking to you. You got fingers, a thumb, a palm, a wrist. Pick up the book. Nothing would happen. Glove, pick it up. Moody would say to his audience, this glove's a dud. How in the world is this glove ever going to pick up this book? There's only one way. Moody would say, and that is if I put my hand into the glove. When I put my hand into the glove, all the power of the hand becomes the power of the glove, and I pick it up. It's not the glove's learned a new trick. Not the glove, all right, I'll do it. Okay, I'll try. The glove has been inhabited by a new hand. You want to pick up a book? You want to form a fist and punch someone on the nose? The glove has all kinds of ability now, because of the life of the hand that's within it. Now, all illustrations are poor. This is a passive piece of material. You and I are not. But the principle is true. But Paul says, we're reconciled to God through the death of Jesus Christ. That's why there's a big cross here this morning. To remind us. That's we're reconciled to God. But much more, exciting than that, is once you're reconciled to God, you'll be saved by his life. His resurrection life will come to live in you and impart to you and to me, not only meaning and strength and give you that sense of completion. You can put your head on the pillow at night and go to sleep. And if you die tomorrow, it doesn't actually matter anymore in the way that it used to. Because it is the risen life of Christ that saves us every day, the resurrection life. And this Easter, there may be some of you here, and yes, you know it's all about a cross. It's all about Jesus Christ, all about a resurrection. But what in the world does it mean? And maybe you begin to understand. It's the means whereby you and I, in our weakness and frailty, can be reconciled to God, that again, we're in touch with God. We have relationship with God. We have communion with God. We know him. And we begin to live in the power of a new life. And there may be some of you watching on television, and you've never come into this relationship for yourself. But God is speaking to you and drawing you. And you sense in your own heart another voice that's not a human voice. Because it's the prerogative of the Spirit of God to draw us to himself. And there's some of you here this morning. And I'm going to finish and I'm going to just pray a simple prayer. You might like to pray it with me. just acknowledging our need for Jesus Christ. Otherwise, you see, this is a little more than just being in the subway station early in the morning on a Friday morning. It has no significance to you. But this is the real thing. Would you pray with me? And if you sense that God has been speaking to you and drawing you, you might like to pray words like this. Lord Jesus Christ, I thank you that you're alive. But you did once die in my place. Now acknowledge my need to you. I need to be forgiven. I need to receive new life, the life of God, and I ask that you will come to live in me. Thank you for hearing my prayer. And Lord, I pray for any who have prayed those words this morning, whose heart is open to you. I pray that as you come to live within them, they will sense in a very real and deep way something new and fresh and life-changing is taking place. Thank you for hearing our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.
Watch this message again, go to our website, livingtruth.ca. You can also order DVDs and CDs, download transcripts, sign up for our monthly newsletter, check out the Living Truth Daily Devotional, sign up for podcasts, and read faith stories from other viewers. We love to hear from you, so send us your comments and testimonies. Living Truth is supported by viewers like you. Thank you for transforming lives through your financial participation. Tune in again next week for another message from Charles Price, Reading Our Circumstances.
God says in His Word that if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And He also says that He takes that sin and He places it as far as the east is from the west, and He remembers it no more. It happened so long ago, and I cried out for mercy back then. I pled the blood of Jesus and begged Him to forgive my sin, but I still can't forget it. It just won't go away. So I wept again, Lord, wash my sin. But this is all He'd say. What sin? What sin? It's as far away as the east is from the west. What sin? What sin? It was gone the very minute you confessed. Buried in the sea of forgetfulness. The heaviest thing you'll carry is a load of guilt and shame. You were never meant to bear them, so let them go. In Jesus' name, our God is slow to anger, quick. quick to forgive our sin. So let them go under the blood. Don't bring them up again, 'cause he'll say, what sin? What sin? It's as far away as the east is from the west. What sin? Oh, what sin? It was gone the very minute you confessed. Buried in the sea of forgetfulness. Oh, oh, Lord, please deliver me from my accusing memory. Nothing makes me weak in this way than when I hear you say, what sin? What sin? It's as far away as the east is from the west. What sin? Oh, what sin? It was gone the very minute you confess. Buried in the sea of forgetfulness.